Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. I'm just outside of Cape Canaveral Space Force Station in Florida, and there's something here that I just have to show you because it's just, it's way too weird and way too cool. This Kerbal fever dream thing is the SM-64 Navajo cruise missile. And it's actually really, really, really cool. There's a ton of awesome technology on this thing. This beautiful monstrosity features both air breathing engines and rocket engines. It's super advanced. They actually had to do a ton of problem solving to get this thing to fly accurately. It features a lot of advanced technologies at the time, considering this thing was built in the 40s. Yeah, it's actually really cool. There's a ton of cool history. So I just wanted to give you a little rundown on some of the technology, on the history of this vehicle, and then just kind of talk about how it ended up losing out to its competitor, the SM-65 Atlas rocket, which went on to be one of the most famous rockets ever flown. So yeah, Navajo cruise missile. Let's get started.
After World War II, the United States saw the need to deliver nuclear warheads from the US to the Soviet Union quickly and autonomously. This was the start of the United States' development of a proper intercontinental ballistic missile system. At the time, nuclear warheads were heavy, so the program's goals eventually stretched to have a payload capacity of up to 4,500 kilograms, and they were aiming at a range of just over 8,000 kilometers. And this was a tall order, considering at the time the only operational cruise missiles were the Nazi-developed V-1 and V-2. The V-1 was only capable of lifting a warhead that was 850 kilograms, about 250 kilometers in distance, and the V-2 could lift 1,000 kilograms up to 320 kilometers. So to lift 4.5 times more mass and send it about 25 times further was an ambitious leap in technology. The Army's Air Force Division tasked manufacturer North American Aviation, or NAA, to develop a capable system. Their design was a two-stage vehicle that leaned on two brand new fangled technologies, the ramjet and the rocket engine. Ramjets are capable of sustaining supersonic flight quite simply and efficiently, but they require a way to get up to speed because they rely on compressing the incoming air to pressurize the combustion chamber. So in order to get the vehicle up to operating speeds, it would need a rocket-powered booster to get it off the ground and up to the appropriate altitude of 15 kilometers with a velocity of about Mach 3. The US wound up flooded with a wealth of knowledge from German scientists who were captured and brought to the United States through a secret program called Operation Paperclip. This gave the engineers at North American Aviation, who eventually split off to become the Rocketdyne Division, a good starting point. Perhaps two of the biggest technologies the Germans were working on to improve rocket engines was using a showerhead injector plate and cylindrical combustion chambers like those used on the KS-50 concepts, as opposed to individual injector cups and spherical chambers like those on the A-4 engine on the V-2. Another technology that NAA were developing for this program was using individually brazed tubes for the walls of the combustion chamber nozzle for regenerative cooling with fuel, instead of using thick and heavy inner and outer walls, which had been done prior. They even started to use the main propellant of ethanol and LOX to power the gas generator, instead of decomposing hydrogen peroxide like previous engines based on the A4. They also developed a clever gear reduction system for the turbo pumps, so they could make the turbine assembly more compact. There was a distinctive squeal at ignition from the gears whining as they spun up. This sound might be familiar to you if you've ever heard a Titan rocket launch startup, because this is basically the previous version of that engine. The engine that they eventually wound up developing for the first flights of the Navajo was called the XLR-71, and this engine right here is basically the genesis of almost every US rocket program and has influenced pretty much every US rocket engine since. But beyond the rocket engine technology, perhaps the most important technology for spaceflight that was developed was the inertial navigation system. The German system had a simple inertial navigation system that could do, you know, some basic navigation, but it was far from accurate. So NAA developed a kinetic double integrating accelerometer, or KDIA, called N1, which would take the acceleration of the vehicle and integrate that to determine location. This led to a fairly accurate system. However, it still drifted at a rate of about 1.6 kilometers per hour, which if you're a cruise missile flying for 3 hours, that's far too big of an error rate. They wound up developing the N2 INS, which they basically just coupled the N1 with a star tracker to help provide mid-course corrections. The program originally was going to have three phases of development. Phase 1 was a supersonic jet-powered vehicle that would test aerodynamics, guidance, and general control for future vehicles called the X-10. There was a major flaw of the Germans' A-4B winged ballistic missile based on the A-4 engine, which had a swept wing design and was unstable at supersonic speeds. This led the X-10 program to use a large delta wing at the back and canards up front to provide the control and stability necessary for supersonic flight. Phase 2 of this program was the G-26 that we see here at the Cape, and it'd be the last vehicle to actually fly in this program. It featured the XLR-71 engines on the booster and a pair of Curtiss-Wright XRJ-47W5 ramjets on the upper stage. Phase 3 would have been the G-38, which would have been about 30% larger and had three more powerful engines that would run on Kerolocks, and these were the XLR-83 on the booster, and it had a few more new technologies like titanium components, solid-state electronics, and gimbaling engines. The G-26, otherwise known as the SM-64 or the ex-SM-64 Navajo, went on to fly 10 times, and as far as I can tell, none of the flights were actually fully successful. At the same time as the Navajo, the SM-65 Atlas was also being developed, and it used many technologies created by the Navajo team. But Atlas could actually hit the same required performance goals as the Navajo, and could hit its targets in about 30 to 45 minutes rather than a few hours, making it even harder to detect or shoot down. Due to the Navajo's troubles and rockets becoming increasingly capable and reliable, the industry shifted to purely rocket-based intercontinental ballistic missiles. The launch of Sputnik in 1957 really put the final nail in the coffin for the Navajo program. The US went full-blown rocket mania, and this led to the space race as we know it today. I'm definitely a bit sad we didn't see rockets and spaceflight move more in this direction, though, for the simple fact that it just looks awesome, and it's easy to imagine a world where instead of John Glenn flying in a tiny little capsule, he was piloting an X-15-looking, vehicle into orbit slung off the side of a mini space shuttle or something that looks more like this. Getting into all this really makes me want to do a deep dive history rundown on all US rocket engines someday, like I did with the Soviet rocket engines. Maybe someday, maybe someday. By the way, I've done a video about why we don't tend to see air launching of rockets all that often, and I have another part coming out where we'll talk about why we don't see highly efficient air breathing engines on rockets. But the Navajo cruise missile is perhaps the best example of combining rockets and air breathing engines. However, it is funny that it's a bit backwards from what would seem to make sense, which is using air breathing engines while in the lower atmosphere and then launching a rocket at high speed and high altitude. It's just kind of funny. Instead, it's using a rocket to get to the air breathing engine up to speed. I just find that kind of funny and ironic. Let me know if you have any other questions or thoughts in the comments below. Don't forget to check out some of my other videos if you want to learn more about rocket technology or rocket history. I owe a huge thank you to my Patreon supporters over at patreon.com/everydayastronaut for making videos like this possible. And while you're online, check out our awesome merch, including our new 1969 collection at everydayastronaut.com/shop. Thanks everybody, that's gonna do it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people. Thank you.